All right, so we are going to get started, everyone.
Great.
So good evening and welcome to the Prime of Your Life Women's Health Series. We're here with today's event, Beam On Proton Therapy for Cancer Treatment with Dr. Raymond Mailhot. My name is Christina Marshall. I'm Business Development Coordinator at the Proton Institute. And I am here with the creators and hosts of the Prime of Your Life Women's Health Series. Dr. Gladys Velarde will be here shortly, and she is the medical director of the UF Health Women's Cardiovascular Program. And Kathy Klein is here, the Women's Heart Program Coordinator at UF Health Jacksonville. So welcome, everyone. I have a few administrative announcements. So we'll keep everyone muted for most of the presentation, but there's going to be plenty of time for discussion once Dr. Mailhot has shared most of his info. And we encourage you to share any questions and comments throughout the presentation. Enter them in the chat box because I can shout them out to Dr. Mailhot so he can respond in a timely manner at that part in the presentation. And at the end, we'll open it up so you can unmute yourself at that time. We are recording this event and may share the audio only, not the video, on the website for Prime of Your Life or the UF Health Jacksonville's YouTube channel. But we will make sure that any names of attendees that are mentioned during discussions are going to be edited out to keep your information confidential. We want to encourage you to participate. But if you have any questions about that, just private chat to me, Christina, or email me after the event. The reminder emails came from me. Lastly, we would love your feedback on today's event. So I'll share a link in this, for the survey in the chat box at the end of the event. Just take a moment to click on the survey. I think it's only like 5 questions, really quick. And the info is on the screen right now for the wellness credit points. And I'll put that in the chat in a little while too. So if you work for UF Health and want the wellness credit points, you can get them. And that's, you'll just need to enter the, send an email with the event name, the event date, and your employee ID number on it. All right, I'm going to turn it over to you, Kathy, the UF Health Jacksonville Women's Heart Program Coordinator.
Hi, everybody. It's great to be together again. I've missed you. We haven't done anything since February, so this has been longer than normal for me, and I can't tell you how excited I am that we're going to get the program started. You know, we are so accustomed to being shoulder to shoulder and with each other in person in a room, but that's just not possible right now, and this is the best that we can do, but being together is what's important. So welcome back. And Dr. Velarde is hoping to zoom in to our Zoom pretty soon. She's out in the hospital now, and so we'll let her interrupt if that becomes something she can do. She wants to say hello to everybody again also. The hospital staff says hello. Everybody's missing you and not would love to feed you, but that's not possible at the moment. So we're going to just do it this way. We have a great presentation for you tonight. I don't need to tell you where the bathrooms are. You already know that. And I don't need to tell you that how to use Zoom, because we've probably all learned it by necessity by now. But we do want to encourage you to continue to be interactive. That's what this program is all about. Dr. Mailhot has generously allowed us to continue to do that. And so there are times during the presentation where he might ask you a question, things where he opens it up for conversation. And of course, at the end, we will always, always do our question and answer format. You know, my pitch is always about letting me know how you feel about things. And so that's why we did the survey at the end. That, as Christina mentioned, will be available. And those kinds of comments and feedback that you give us normally on a paper evaluation are provided through this survey. And it's just as important as it's ever been to keeping the program going. So thank you so much. We've had a bunch of people want to participate. So we're going to hope to see how the Zoom format works. What I'd like to do right now is tell you a little bit about Dr. Mailhot. And we've had a different speaker. Dr. Bradley was here last year or maybe even 12 months ago or more to talk about how proton therapy helped with breast cancer. And we wanted to do an update about proton therapy because it's used to treat so many different kinds of cancers. It's right next to us here at the hospital on our campus, and we're thrilled to have them. So let me tell you a little bit about Dr. Mayo, because I wanted to introduce you to some additional information about Proton, and he's a perfect person to do that for us. Dr. Mayo is an assistant professor in the Department of Radiation Oncology at the University of Florida, and he practices at the Proton Therapy Institute. His areas of treatment and research include proton therapy for pediatric cancer, breast cancer, and lymphoma. He completed his undergraduate and medical training at Washington University in St. Louis, and post-grad training at Harvard University and New York University. He serves on the committee for the American Society of Radiation Oncology. He's a national board member of the Hodgkin Lymphoma Committee on Children's Oncology Group. He was awarded the Global Oncology Young Investigator Award grant by Conquer Cancer Foundation and selected as a finalist for the University of Florida's International Educator of the Year. He also had an opportunity to work for the World Health Organization in Switzerland. And we're thrilled to have him here tonight to tell us a little bit more about proton therapy and cancer. So Dr. Mayo, I know you're on and listening, and I'd love to turn it over to you to begin the presentation.
Sure. Thank you very much for that introduction. I'm just going to start sharing my screen. And I do want to echo what you and Christina mentioned with the idea that I want this to be as interactive as possible. And I think this is our first launching of a continuing prime of your life in a virtual setting. And so please don't hesitate to send any kind of chat or to wave your hands at me so I can make sure that I get any question that's possible. Because I know sometimes it's hard to wait till the end to ask a question if it's right in your mind. You know, as we do translate to the virtual setting, it may be that I'm not making as much eye contact as we would in person if I'm looking at slides. And also I'm in kind of a room with a time limited light. So if you see me start to wave my hands, it's because I'm under a motion sensor. But thank you very much for the introduction. And I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. So as was mentioned, I'm here today and I wanted to take the opportunity to talk about proton therapy. My colleague, Dr. Bradley, had previously spoken about its use in breast cancer, but I wanted to go at a higher altitude and just review again what cancer is and what are the different treatment options and how does proton therapy relate to that, and actually highlight the amazing resource that we have in our own backyard, something that I'm proud of as a Floridian and that we can recognize in Jacksonville. Christina will help me along the way in case anyone chats. Someone who's going to help guide us through this presentation is going to be a lot of what we do in medical school is kind of a case series, or the idea that we're following a patient or a person throughout and who helps us learn and take away items for teaching. And so for the purpose of this, I wanted to introduce y'all to a woman named Maria, who is going to help us learn about cancer treatment as well as the role of proton therapy. So as mentioned, I am a radiation oncologist, and I want to define what that means. You know, the word oncologist means a doctor who treats cancer, but we'll go over different types of treatments, and some oncologists work with radiation, such as myself. Some can be surgeons, and some can specialize more in something like chemotherapy. I do have the extreme privilege of treating patients with breast cancer, and a passion is treating my child patients who have pediatric cancers. I direct our lymphoma program, which does bridge between children and adults, and I trained at NYU and Harvard. Just something I love to share is this, I actually got this about 3 weeks ago, and if it doesn't look like me, it's because I'm wearing glasses. But it's actually from, it's a little picture of our center, and I'm in it. You can see my little title if I didn't look enough like it. And we do serve an amazingly diverse community. You can see Gracias written at the top right, and we actually have wind chimes and a piano in our lobby in case you're able ever to come visit. A little more about me. I was born and raised in Alabama. You see, I went to the Northeast for a little while. My first language is actually Spanish. My family's from Honduras, but my last name is French because my dad's from Quebec, but you typically learn the language of your mom. And so I'm really excited to be here today to share this hour with you. And so what we're gonna talk about is, what is cancer? You know, that word gets thrown around a lot, but actually understanding what it is important to the second point. What are the options that we actually have to treat it? Where does radiation fit into that? And then within radiation, what is proton therapy? And then what is the place that I work that UFPTI or the University of Florida Proton Therapy Institute. So a lot of times whenever we hear the word cancer, it ultimately goes down to a microscopic level, you know, something that we can't necessarily see with our eyes. And people may, you know, you might hear in the news on NPR or various news organizations how cancer relates to DNA. And so on the left, we have a picture of DNA, and usually a textbook might say that the DNA is the blueprint of our cells, that it helps our cells know how to build themselves and how to construct themselves. To be honest, I've actually never seen blueprints. I know what they are in theory, but what I'm more familiar with is cooking, and I imagine a lot of people might be as well. And so another way that I tend to think of DNA is kind of a recipe. It's a recipe book. And the problem with cancer happens when some of those recipes go off kilter. And so when I talk about cooking, I like baking, although donuts involve fryers, so I don't do it as much. But if we think of our cells as being highly organized, you know, you've heard of white cells, red blood cells, other cells in the body that make up all of our organs. They're typically ordered and there's a natural organization to it. That's because those recipes can be followed. But if there's ever kind of an error in this recipe book, as opposed to the nice round traditional glazed donuts, you might get an irregular donut. Maybe this was supposed to be cake with a purple glazing, but it's clearly not what it was supposed to be. You could get a true cake donut, but what happens is with cancer is that that recipe book just continues and continues. And so if we think of ourselves in the kitchen, what that would be equivalent to is that process just continuing without any stop. You might remember in Fantasia, you can tell I work with children. The classic scene where Mickey is with a broom and that mop and that bucket, and he just loses control of that whole situation because the mops keep reproducing. And that's similar with this, but it comes at the expense of what is needed for that kitchen. So all the flour, all the eggs, all the sugar end up going for these aberrant or abnormal donuts. Whereas opposed, we used to have a very nice, you know, pattern to the organization. It really cannibalizes the resources. And that's ultimately what cancer is, this uncontrolled dividing. And the actual definition, if you look at how the National Cancer Institute defines it, it's a term for any disease, you know, where abnormal cells divide without being able to be controlled. And then they start to spread to nearby tissues. So that idea that those mops go all around that building that Mickey was in, or that the kitchen is totally invaded, all the way up to the rest of the house. These cells that have cancer can also spread to other parts of the body through the blood and the lymph systems. And so as we start contextualizing it and saying, how does that feel from a first person perspective, that brings us back to Maria. And so at home, she feels something in her breast. She feels a lump. And so Christina's gonna help with the first poll. What should she do next?
All right, a few more moments to get your votes in. See what we've got here. I'm going to share the results.
Excellent.
That's what everybody says.
So I'm very glad that people are doing the poll as we're transitioning to this virtual environment. And these results are very informative. I would agree with the most popular result, to see a physician. You know, anytime that someone detects something different on themselves, I think seeing a doctor is perfectly, that's our role. That's why we're here, is to help people better understand some type of change to how they've been feeling. Getting a mammogram, though, is right to the point. You know, I did mention this idea that she felt something in her breast, and that is typically what a physician may recommend if they feel it. It wouldn't have been bad to ask a friend, but I would honestly, you know, because we normally do ask each other if we notice something different, but I would underscore that ask a friend wouldn't necessarily replace see a doctor. So I highly agree with what everyone determined as the most popular answer, and I agree with the getting a mammogram as well. So she sees a doctor who orders a mammogram, which were, you know, the two responses that we had. And then as we continue to follow her, what that ends up resulting in is a biopsy, meaning that someone actually takes a sample of that lump and then looks like what it look sees what it looks like under a microscope. Unfortunately, this does show that she has breast cancer. So she then goes to see an oncologist. And so at this point, this is kind of a more personal question, where I really want to lean on the chat function. What do you think is on Maria's mind?
Any thoughts? Like, how are you gonna handle cancer in your job? Will I die? Just some fear, concerned and stressed about her future.
I think it's all of those responses that run through your mind, because I had a scare a few years ago. Found a mass, and it was benign. Everything was fine. Had a lumpectomy done, but a lot of stuff ran through my mind. You know how, because my mom was a breast cancer survivor, and she had a mastectomy. So a lot of stuff goes through your head.
Yeah.
When it happens to you, and then fortunately for me, it was benign, but they removed the mask. I didn't take a second thought, and I cried a lot, you know. So, but it's very emotional, and everybody deals with things differently. And I try to help hold a brave face for a minute, but in fact, I had my mom to rely on, because like I said, she was survivor. And I mean, when she had her breast removed, her first response was I can win a wet t-shirt contest now, you know. So everybody handles things differently. So, you know, and thank you for listening.
Thank you very much for sharing. I think that, I'm very glad that we're able to create a safe space where you can say something so personally and share the survivorship story of your mother. And I 100% agree with what you were saying about your own experience, about at least what I can say, having seen other patients experience something. Everyone's different. That was one thing you said, which is completely true. But the emotions that you said that you felt with your scare is something that I see quite commonly, you know, fear, crying. I think that's a very natural response to the idea that something is scary and that there's a loss of control in a lot of cases. But you did mention that everyone is different, and some people can get very, you know, information based. What do I do next? What do I do next? So there's a real range in how people react. And again, I want to thank you for sharing. So, you know, Maria could be feeling any number of those emotions as she's in this journey, but ultimately she's finding herself meeting people that she didn't expect to meet. And I will acknowledge I have an unfortunate job where no one wants to meet me, but it is our job to work together to guide through patients through these obstacles, things that they didn't necessarily foresee, but how do we do that as a team? So again, thank you for sharing. But this brings us to what she might be seeing then, like how do we treat cancer? And so in our toolbox, there's usually three main instruments that we have. There's surgery on the left, on the right, there's radiation. And in the middle, it's a giant umbrella, actually. It's systemic treatment, which may involve something like chemotherapy, hormone treatments, or immunotherapy. And this is what really differentiates the type of oncologist you may see, because in general, one oncologist focuses only on one of these three areas. There are surgeons whose job is to remove tumors. That would be a surgical oncologist. A medical oncologist is usually the person who's the quarterback behind directing chemotherapy or the hormone treatments. And then it's a radiation oncologist, such as myself, who would be in charge of radiation oncology. But why are there three different specialists? A lot of it has to do with the training involved. the residency for radiation is very different than you'd imagine the skills necessary to be an excellent surgeon. And so it's really this team, also including the patient, that really is guiding care. But how are they similar and how are they different? So I'll go back and forth between these. And surgery is, I think, the most intelligible, because in general, we've all had surgery for something, a wisdom tooth removal, perhaps a broken bone. Surgery removes something, and it's what we call a focal treatment. So what I generally compare it to is when we think about how treatments operate, we also think about how treatments create side effects. So if someone had knee surgery, you wouldn't expect their elbow to hurt. And that's an example, because if it's a focal treatment. And if we had to say, is surgery more similar to radiation or systemic treatment? It's more similar to radiation. So something I always want to address, you know, as a possible myth, is that when we talk about radiation and its use for cancer, 98-99% of the times, it's very focused. So it's another example of a focal treatment, meaning that if something is being targeted, such as if Maria, if she ends up having a recommendation to receive radiation, it's only in that area that's being targeted that may have side effects. It's not the whole body that's being targeted. And the second myth is that someone who's receiving radiation is generally not radioactive, unless you're swallowing something, which happens with certain types of thyroid diseases. In general, someone receiving radiation is not radioactive and doesn't have to be away from their family for that reason. But the middle one, systemic treatment, that's when we think of chemotherapy. And so when we start to think about how that's different, that's the second one. And so this is where side effects might be different, because systemic refers to the fact that that medication goes throughout the entire body. And what that can mean is that the side effects can happen to other parts of the body that aren't related necessarily to where the tumor is. Meaning that perhaps, you know, through a friend or family, you might have seen someone undergo chemotherapy and they might, for example, lose their hair or feel nauseous or experience something that's not necessarily near the area that's being targeted. And why that happens is because that medication goes throughout the entire body, which is different from surgery and radiation. So one thing I like to point out about radiation is that if you've ever had an X-ray or a CAT scan or a CT, that's actually radiation. The radiation we use to actually cure cancer is generally just at a higher energy, but it's something then that if you've experienced, you can't see, smell, touch, taste, or feel radiation. Doesn't mean that there might not be side effects, but the actual act of receiving radiation is not something that we as human beings can actually perceive. And I'll actually come back to this in a little bit too. How does it work? You know, we talk about it a lot, but of the three, surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation, I think radiation tends to be more of a black box. There's a certain mystery behind it. Again, typically because a lot of people have had surgery for some reason, it's pretty intelligible. You know, something is being removed. There may be anesthesia and time to recuperate, but it's usually a one-day procedure. With radiation, it's not really depicted in the media. You know, there's not a lot of movies that feature it, TV shows, so unless you've experienced or someone close to you, it tends to be the one that's a little more mysterious. So the way that it works is it actually damages DNA. So if we think about, again, that kind of recipe book that our cells use to create what they need to, it blocks cell division and reproduction. So what happens is those brooms that are going out of control stop multiplying. We would have saved Mickey a headache. But both cancerous and healthy cells can be affected. But it's the fact that the recipe book of cancer cells are already kind of damaged. The ink is a little messed up. There's smudges on it. It's harder for them to be able to cope with the way that the recipe is changing even more. Normally our cells can, if there is DNA damage, know how to recuperate from it. But because cancer cells already have DNA issues, it's harder for them to manage that. And all tissues, meaning healthy ones too, have a certain level of tolerance, how much DNA damage they can actually receive. And it's what exceeding that tolerance can cause damage, such as side effects, either in the short term or later in life. And so when we think about radiation and side effects, what they're a function of is where the tumor is located and the dose that's being actually used for the treatment. So it's a function of those two things. So in Maria's case, she has a lumpectomy and she sees a radiation oncologist, that's someone like me. And that person has recommended radiation for her breast cancer. And so we'll go to another poll. So Maria has a friend whose sister had lung cancer. And her friend said that immunotherapy was really effective for her. Should she ask her oncologist about it? Occasionally you'll see me drink.
So, that's what everybody said.
Y'all are killing me. That's an excellent answer. So that's what I was hoping you would say. So always feel comfortable asking a physician any question. You know, if you're on a team with someone, you don't want to, and there's something that's, you know, bothering you at the end of your mind or something you've seen effective for a friend or a loved one, please ask about it. Do we necessarily use immunotherapy for breast cancer? Not that often, but that doesn't mean that asking about it is in any way incorrect. The goal that the relationship that you should have with your physician, in particular, you know, I'm speaking as an oncologist, that I want my patients to have with me is one of trust. And so if you've seen something be effective and safe and seen someone succeed through that, it's 100% you should ask about it and if it applies to you. Oh, now I see the chat box. Sorry. I echo Christina. Thank you all for sharing your previous chat. And so now we have a second poll.
The side effects question, is that what we're looking for here?
Yeah.
Okay. There we go. Sorry.
So what side effects may be on Maria's mind when they're discussing receiving radiation to treat her breast?
You guys are answering fast now. All right, a few more seconds. Get your votes in. All right, that's what everybody said.
Great, so it looks like the most common responses were skin changes. You know, a lot of times you might have heard friends or family. Again, I don't think it's that often in the media, but a lot of times when I meet patients, they'll say friends or family who've undergone an experience and talk about skin changes from radiation and compare it to something like a sunburn. So that I think is something that definitely if Maria has known something, someone who's undergone this would be on her mind. That was tied with hair loss, and that's a lot on a lot of patients' minds. And this is where we start to separate what can be caused by different treatments. You know, because breast cancer and radiation itself is a focal treatment to the breast, radiation, when the breast is treated, doesn't cause hair loss. It's definitely something that's on people's minds, so I 100% agree that I think it would be something on Maria's mind. And that's similar, again, to nausea. You know, when we do see on the media or through friends and family, a lot of times some treatments can cause nausea. But again, when we think about focal treatment that's not away from the part of the brain that controls nausea, it's not really common with radiation. So in her case, 100% agree it may be on her mind, but it'd be unlikely for something that she would experience. Fatigue? Oh, I actually missed the most common one. It was on the bottom. I said that it was orange, but I missed it. Fatigue is a great answer, in the sense that that is something that is common with any of the three treatments, you know, to take a step back, flying even higher. Surgery, systemic treatment, and radiation can all cause fatigue. So I think that's a very valid thing that would be on Maria's mind and an answer from the audience. And then finally, low white cell count, or the fact that someone can have high infection, is something that we can see with different cancer treatments. Again, when only the breast is treated, it's not as common, but we do see it something when we think about people who may be receiving certain types of chemotherapy. If you've ever had, been in the situation where a friend or family or colleague has undergone that, you may notice that sometimes they're recommended to not be so close to people or not to go to crowded places for that concern of getting an infection. So all great responses. And so as we're moving forward, you know, we took a pause to talk about Maria and what was on her mind. But when I mentioned the fact that side effects are a function of where is being treated and the dose that's being used, well, what are the healthy organs that we have to think about as radiation oncologists to make sure that we're never exceeding that level of tolerance we talked about, to make sure that those healthy organs stay healthy? The most common ones are typically, and the ones that we kind of prioritize are the spinal cord. You know, that's the entire pathway that lets us move our arms and legs and sends up any information that's happening below our neck to our brain. Things that control vision. The brainstem is basically the top of the spinal cord. The heart, because we do know that if the heart gets damaged, that can cause something like heart disease. The lungs, which we use for breathing. The liver, which basically acts as a processing plant for our body to get rid of impurities and toxins. Then the intestines, you know, what our body uses to actually absorb nutrients. So all these are examples of critical organs, but this is not a complete or exhaustive list. It's just kind of highlights of something that may be going on in your physician's mind as well as in the team of the physician with the patient. But this comes to the ultimate question, well, what can we do to actually make radiation easier and safer? And so when we talked about conventional radiation or what's used in 99% of radiation oncology centers, and also what we offer here, because the fact that it's Proton Therapy Institute may lead people to think that we only do protons, but again, it's just an extra tool that we have access to. So we still do conventional radiation. What conventional radiation is x-rays. So that image I showed back here is actually what conventional radiation is, just at a higher energy. And the way that x-rays work, you know, if you're ever trying to take an image and see if someone has a bone fracture, is they go straight through something. So the way the image works is you think of a camera, except that what you're trying to develop on the film is on the other side of what you're taking a picture of. So you have your camera in front, what you're trying to image, like someone's hand, but then what's actually receiving the information is behind the hand. So that x-ray goes straight through, and that's how an x-ray works. But if that's happening, what that might mean is in someone's arm, there might be healthy tissues that's still getting some of that x-rays as they travel through the body. So can we be any more precise with the way that we're actually delivering the radiation? And so now we're gonna talk about physics, and this is a great picture of Albert Einstein. So what protons are, you might remember back from a physics class, you know, the difference between protons, neutrons, and electrons. They're a charged product particle. And as opposed to x-rays, which don't have a charge and travel straight through something, protons have a charge, and charged particles stop when they give energy. So based on the amount of energy a proton is given, it'll travel, it'll go to a certain point, and then it'll deposit all that energy. So if we look at our person on the right, who has it, where we're trying to treat a tumor but avoid the heart, that's what's represented in this graph, that we're trying to deliver radiation and dose to where the tumor is, but do it in such a way that we're keeping the heart as healthy as it can be, because we're not worried about cancer involving the heart. What we're trying to treat is the area where the tumor is. And actually, by changing the energies for each individual proton, we can actually safely deliver the radiation dose that we want to the tumor and have it drop off nicely to keep the heart healthy. And to go a little bit into too much detail, the name of that phenomenon for charged particles doing that is called the Bragg peak. But let's talk about a more contextual example. So we had in our mind that graph that we had of trying to treat a tumor and having that fall off right here. And if we're actually comparing again, you know, we're talking about Maria and her own journey through the management of her breast cancer. What we have is a representation published by my colleague, Dr. Bradley, who spoke last year, of two different plans. One of them using photons, which is the other way word for conventional radiation, and one delivering protons. And this area in orange is actually the heart. So to orient ourselves, this is the front of her body, the back, that's the spine. This white area is the ribs, the lungs, and then in the middle is the heart. And so she's receiving treatment to her left breast. What we can see here on this slice is that the photon treatment, both of them are very much treating the breast, which is the goal of the treatment. But in this case on the right, some of the heart is receiving more radiation than it is on the left. And another way of looking at it is instead in this plane, where we're looking at her as if she's standing on the side. And so here we have the left breast again, the spine, the lung, and still circled in orange is the heart. And we're able to see on the left that those colors, which represent dose, are able to better circle the heart and treat the area that needs to be treated, but avoiding it, as opposed to the area on the right, which is a conventional or a photon plan. Just one more example that I think highlights again the precision is an example of someone who has something called a paraspinal sarcoma. A sarcoma is a type of cancer that can involve either muscles or bones, so the kind of structure to our body. Paraspinal just refers to the fact that it's around someone's spine. And again, if we keep in mind the fact that we have this idea of a Bragg peak, what we have here is something that we actually use for treatment. So anyone who needs treatment undergoes a CT. But in this patient's case, they had an MRI 6 weeks later. And what we can see is the area clearly delineated by where the radiation treated, but also importantly stopped. That you can see the area in the vertebra, which are the bones that make up our spine, that was affected by the radiation and how it didn't go any further. But how do we know if a treatment is better than another treatment? You know, another word we may use in medicine is superior. You know, the most common way we'll typically assess that is something called a randomized control trial. And so if we say that there's a hypothetical disease, typically what will happen is then people, you know, will hear about this trial either through advertisements, speaking with their doctor, different message boards or cancer support groups, and they'll learn about it and they may enroll. And typically what it involves is a comparison between some type of treatment, in this example, a white pill, versus a yellow and red one. And they'll be followed and seen which one is better. And that's what generally guides us in medicine, you know, be it in oncology or any other specialty, to know what is best for patients, is something called a randomized control trial. And so it's through this type of methodology that we determine what is better, or in other words, is what is superior. So this is an example of the NCI, which again, we went over the abbreviation, but it's the National Cancer Institute. So this is what on a governmental level is being sponsored in order to investigate the superiority of proton therapy. And you can see a lot of cancers are being studied for this treatment. Breast cancer, this right here is a type of brain cancer, cancer of the lung, the prostate in men, of the esophagus, of the liver, and then another type of brain tumor. So this is something that's very popular, not only necessarily because we have the University of Florida Proton Therapy Institute, but something that the government itself and that national scientists and cooperative groups are also sensing that and having the finger on the pulse on. And a number of these we also offer here. So for what cancers do we utilize proton therapy? And this is where I'll get a little more as I talk about each one. There's no more graphics for this slide, but it'll just be me mentioning, as I consider it as a radiation oncologist, different benefits that we've seen. So with breast cancer, again, when we think about the anatomy, because that's what radiation is a function of, what's near what and what can be effective? Really a goal of proton therapy is to prevent heart disease with, you know, evidence demonstrating that in some cases, radiation can be associated with heart disease, can improved or more precise radiation in the form of proton therapy actually be a way that we can reduce heart disease. Pediatric cancer is actually where it's most commonly employed nationally and even internationally. You know, the catchment or where people come from to receive radiation in Jacksonville is actually international. You know, having relationships with Canada, the United Kingdom, and Norway, particularly for pediatric cases, just because if we're talking about reducing side effects, well, if a child is 5 years old, then we have a major onus as an oncologist to make sure that that person is healthy, not only when they're 6 or 7 years old, but when they're 35 years old, when they're 55 years old. So really, if we change our frame of mind that what we're wanting to do is maximize quality of life, then particularly for our younger patients who have so much life ahead of them, that's a real area where we've seen proton therapy utilized, not only locally, but nationally and internationally. With cancers of the head and neck, you know, I mentioned that everything tends to be a function of anatomy and dose. For the radiation dose that we use to actually cure cancers of the head and neck, you might remember that Michael Douglas had a cancer a couple years ago, and what his was a cancer of the head and neck. They typically go to the higher end of that radiation doses. So it can be a lot of side effects can happen during treatment and afterwards. But through the use of proton therapy, because that dose is so high, we try, there's dose improvements in some of the structures that can cause side effects. You know, we don't think about it if you don't experience, but there's a lot of quality of life we get by having a moist mouth. As odd as that sounds, but dry mouth can be one of the most uncomfortable sensations to have. And that can be an unfortunate side effect of radiation. Again, when we think of lung cancer, that's kind of a combination of what I just mentioned with the high dose of a cancer of the head and neck, but also the location, you know, that's still the chest area. So we have to think about the heart. We have to think about other important organs nearby, including the lung itself. And there's actually evidence that's demonstrated that for people who require both chemotherapy and radiation, and this is published at out of WashU, that there's actually been reduced hospitalizations and acute side effects, meaning short-term side effects, with proton therapy when they compared that against patients who had received photon therapy. But other cancers in which proton therapy is utilized, particularly in our center, is sarcoma, lymphoma, which is the program that I direct, pancreatic cancer, because you think that that's right in the middle of our abdomen, so there's so many organs involved in digestion all nearby. Cancer of the esophagus, again, which is in our chest, and that heart sits right in front. Brain tumors, and that's, again, particularly related to pediatric cancers, because one of the most areas that's most common to have a tumor in a child, unfortunately, can involve the brain. And we do know that radiation of the brain can impact a lot of things. You know, brain is very prime real estate. There's a ton of organs that are involved in growth. You know, we hear about the endocrine system, and an example of that's the pituitary. Imagine that that's kind of the hard drive of the entire computer that is our body, and it controls growth, it controls our temperature, it controls, you know, how we react in an emergency. And organs like that, particularly in a child, are more sensitive than they are in an adult. And also, a child's brain is growing. So there's evidence that's shown that proton therapy is better at being able to maintain a child's intellectual capacity or their IQ compared to more conventional radiation. But other examples include cancers of the eye, of the liver, and prostate cancer. And so to be, you know, proud of where I work and proud of, you know, what's a great resource in our city is the University of Florida Proton Therapy Institute. So it was the first proton therapy facility to open in the Southeast and the fifth one to open in the United States. We're an academic research institute, so we do invite patients or discuss with them opportunities to be on trial, some of which I mentioned, but some of them are not necessarily listed in this presentation. We have a lot of years of experience in treating with proton therapy. Also considering the fact that proton therapy is about 20 years old in terms of the oldest center within the United States, as we were the fifth. We've treated the most patients in the Southeast, and there's 12 of us on staff. Despite the short amount of time that, you know, 12 years, we have treated over 8,000 patients, and we're the largest radonc practice in Florida. You'll notice that a radiation oncologist may abbreviate that to radonc. And we have more years combined of an experience with proton therapy than anyone in the South. So again, I'm proud of where I work. And again, it's an amazing resource that we have in our own backyard. And this is just an example of cases that we've treated and only focusing on those that are children. And you'll see that each circle represents a number of children and then where they're from. And so everyone is honestly coming to Jacksonville for this treatment that's in our backyard. I mentioned the, you know, the relationships that we particularly had with the United Kingdom and Canada, but it really is an international catchment, meaning where are people coming from to receive this? So in conclusion, you know, as we are thinking about what might be on Maria's mind, I actually skipped the poll. But something that is generally in the mind, not only of the physicians and the patients, but everyone involved in the entire team, is how to maximize quality of life. If curative treatment or that goal comes at such a high cost, a lot of times people may ask, is it really worth it? You know, is life after this treatment with that type of side effect really what I define as the priority for me in my decision-making? And that's very individual. Some people might say yes, some people might say no. But if we have the possibility to maintain that cure rate and still make people feel better, well, I think that's something to pursue. All cancer treatment is supported by trials and studies to determine what is most successful. And so I relate this to the time that Maria asked about, does immunotherapy apply to her? You know, it might, and it might not, but it's good that she asked. But anytime that a physician mentions that, you know, these are the treatment options, it's not necessarily a function of, you know, it's a function of what cancer someone might be undergoing, but also where's all the evidence? All those randomized control trials we talked about, all those publications, are really what's guiding the medical decisions that physicians typically recommend. And so published evidence demonstrates that proton therapy can minimize dose to healthy organs that are near tumors. And we talked about some of that other evidence, you know, how it relates to to children and the ability to maintain IQ. And what proton therapy is, it's another tool that we have. You know, I talked about a number of tools, surgery, immunotherapy, chemotherapy, conventional radiation. And this is something else that we have in our utility belt as a, in order to try to reach that goal for a cure for cancer. But the most important takeaway that I would want to have for anyone listening to this is that you and your physician are on a team. And so ask any question that you would normally ask a friend or family. You don't want to hold back from the person that's on your team. I'm excited for the question portion of this. And I, again, just want to thank you again for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mayo. Do you want to do your last poll, kind of at see where everybody's priorities, what their highest priority would be? Let's throw that out there. All right, what are your thoughts after this discussion? What would be the most important thing to you? All right, a few more moments. We'll see what you thought. Thank you guys so much for all your involvement. All right, let's see what the results were. Interesting.
I think this makes complete sense, a split between cure rate and quality of life. I think everyone's different. You know, we heard someone share that earlier, and I think this attests to it. Unfortunately, you know, some people do have, you know, costs can be on people's mind as well, and particularly time.
Yeah.
So again, I very much appreciate y'all's interactivity and the invitation.
We do have a couple of questions in the chat. So one is, how often does Proton Research report out results about how Proton is different from traditional radiation?
I think that's all the time, you know, in the sense that there are, where do I get my news from? There are medical journals that essentially publish, you know, the way that we think that there's Newsweek, Time Magazine, The Economist. There are similar journals that solely report out medical information or the results of trials or just the results of evidence. And so these are always, there's some actual journals that are solely dedicated to particle therapy, which proton therapy is a type of, but it's also reported by other journals that deal with radiation oncology specifically, or even cancer treatment in general. So really all the time we're seeing new reports coming up. We have a question about what is the survival rate with proton therapy? So that's an excellent question. I think what this goes to is how is proton therapy different than conventional radiation? So unless the dose that is being used is different, the benefit that we are aiming to see with proton therapy isn't necessarily one of improved cure. And I wanna go over that again. So let's go back to our slide. What we're aiming to see is less of a side effect. So in some cases, it may be that there is improved survival because a certain organ isn't receiving radiation that's healthy. But in both cases, if the breast is being treated, then we assume the breast itself is going to be cured. The breast cancer itself will have a similar cure rate. What may be different is someone's risk of having heart disease later in life. So that could be tied to survival, but in terms of, you know, trial data, that's something that we're still waiting for. So I just want to make that distinction between a cure rate and, again, this idea of quality of life. That if someone is undergoing a treatment, can we make that treatment easier for them during it, but also in the years that follow?
I know that Dr. Velarde wants to say hello. Is that all right if she interrupts and says hello?
Oh, please, yeah.
I hope, yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Well, thank you so much. I think that was wonderful. Dr. Mea, thank you so much for being the groundbreaker of our first virtual Prime of Your Life. This is you're breaking ground here, and your slides were so colorful, and I think very much tell the story of your talk that I hope the audience is getting the gist of what it is. First, on the one hand, having professionals such as yourself of high caliber that are, you know, that it is such a a pleasure and an honor to have that in our own backyard in Jacksonville, like you said. And secondly, that, you know, programs like this elevate the knowledge of our community. And I am so happy to see that a lot of people join. So thanks for the effort. Thank you to Christina. Thank you to Kathy. But I don't want to interrupt if there are more questions. You know, I think they're very important. I particularly enjoy your graphics about protecting the heart for obvious reasons. but I want you know, people to participate, and I don't know if you know, if there are more questions in the chat. And I also want to know if there's a shortcut that we have created or not created to tweet it. Because I tweeted to you some things that I just posted. So as I was driving and listening to you at the same time. So a little nuts on my part. But I don't want to distract for the participants if they have. The questions have been great, because I think that's what, you know, when you say the word cancer, that's the fear. And having gone through that in my own family, it's a devastating word. You know, you don't want to hear it, but you have to, and know what your options are, and know the plan and how to approach it. So your talk is so important. So I'm gonna let the audience, but thank you again for doing this. I'm breaking ground.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. To go back to the questions, someone asked, is proton therapy covered by most major insurances? So again, I think it depends upon what cancer we're discussing, because not to go too much into the weeds, but the way that insurance coverage works is that things are generally tied to a diagnosis code, meaning that if Maria has breast cancer, but then her brother Mario has prostate cancer, those are very different codes, and that also has to deal with the general A, treatment that may be involved, and then B, what the policy typically may be. So in the case of pediatric cancers, I'll say very fortunately, pretty much all children under 21 have coverage, but it does become more dependent upon the different tumor that we're discussing. And then in many times as a radiation oncologist, what I actually do is actually advocate two different ways. Sometimes we may actually provide a plan like this. There may be patients where this photon treatment may be perfectly okay, and we don't see as big a difference, because we're all different. And what I'm talking about are shapes in our anatomy. All of us are shaped different. So some people might have more room, honestly, between what we're trying to treat and that healthy organ. But it's for the people that they're very close to that we may need to advocate a little more. And that may actually involve demonstrating to someone, hey, this is the benefit that we have with this. This is the result of that. This is what the benefit looks like for this particular person, like Maria. To speak about my research, I actually, why I was at Harvard partly before internship was I was getting my master's, which focuses on comparative effectiveness and cost effectiveness analysis. So my actual particular area of research is to try to demonstrate where we see this benefit and to use that as a tool to help inform policymakers, be that people in government, people in insurance, healthcare systems, to better advocate for people who can actually benefit from it. I'm going to save the question from April to the end, or I'll address it now. So I think just speaking to how much I love the international community, what April, this is through Twitter, you know, Dr. Velarde mentioned that, stands for Asociación Española de Proton Terapia. So they're actually Spanish colleagues who are listening to this conversation from Spain. So I very much appreciate their attendance. And their question is, how do we update guidelines of national organizations to increase the clinical indications in proton therapy? I actually think that's best answered by Kathy's question, which how often is research reported out? I think it's continuing on as scientists, as doctors, as physicians, as researchers, to share our evidence as we continue to publish it, that we increase the clinical indications. You know, through the willingness and the a lot of this, of our success, always relies on the support of patients. You know, I mentioned that things that we do, be it in oncology or cardiology, are a function of trials. Well, the people at the end of the day who are participating in those trials are patients. So it's through, you know, the interaction and teamwork of patients who are willingly being a part of trials and spending their time, and then physicians who are continuing to publish the research and take advantage of that, that I think we'll be able to demonstrate its indications. We have another question. Is proton therapy effective for all types of breast cancer? So again, I think that this is where I can hear that question and answer it a number of ways. Because when we think of types of breast cancer, in some ways I might hear that and think of stage. You know, you might have heard that cancers have different stages, stage 1, 2, 3, and 4. When we typically think of stage 4, that means something is metastatic or that it could spread to somewhere else. And in someone who has breast cancer, which is Maria throughout this story, that may be to the bones. We don't typically use radiation in women who have stage 4 cancer, but I guess the way that I'll answer that is, in instances where we use photon radiation for breast cancer, I don't think there's nothing incorrect by asking a physician or asking an oncologist, hey, is this a situation where proton therapy may be effective? And I just want to distinguish that, because typically if we're saying type means stage, we don't use radiation for every specific situation of breast cancer, because breast cancer comes in so many shapes and sizes. Unfortunately, it's the most common cancer in the United States, affecting 200,000 women a year. And some of them do have metastatic cancer at diagnosis. So it depends upon the situation, but I think a fair rule of thumb is, if radiation is being recommended, it's okay and it behooves everyone to ask, is this the best way that's for me? Or is there another option? We have another question. I'm asking as a physical therapist, now I'm reading out loud. So from a viewpoint of being a physical therapist that works with oncology patients, I want to understand what level or dose will affect skin, bone, soft tissue, muscle, and or tendon. I think that's very anatomy specific about what's being radiated. It's an excellent question, because I very much appreciate that we're contextualizing this talk. Like, what does that mean in terms of my profession, my day-to-day life? But I think it's very specific about what treatment is being received and where, because sometimes someone might have a treatment where there's a combination of surgery and radiation, which can impact the movements of different muscles of different bones and joints. Or sometimes it's the combination of chemotherapy and radiation, which again affects how the actual side effects may be different. I do invite anyone with specific questions. I'd be happy to, you know, go into more detail offline, you know, one-on-one, but that's an excellent question. And if I did not mention it or said in a way that's unclear, this is very much FDA approved. I think just with any type of treatment, we always want to publish on it, because that's how we learn about things that are effective. You might have heard about immunotherapy, because I keep mentioning that, and there's ads everywhere. But to be honest, that is something that has really been groundbreaking in the treatment and curative treatment of lung cancer. And so I think just as we continue to report out where immunotherapy is effective, not only in lung cancer, but other cancers, because it's being studied in all types of cancers because of how effective it is. It behooves us, and it's our duty to continue to report out how effective proton therapy it is. And then there was a clarification for triple negative breast cancer. So yes, to answer that specifically, in situations of women who have triple negative breast cancer where radiation is recommended, so if it's not stage 4, then proton therapy is something that we offer. But it's a discussion again between your oncologist and you about, or a person, you know, for every specific situation, but triple negative breast cancer is not a reason that proton therapy is not used. I'm answering that in the negative, but it's hard because I think that there may be a specific thought in mind, but I want to be as blanket, because I know that there's other participants as well.
We have another question that asks, is COVID affecting cancer patients more? What are you seeing, those with active cancer or under treatment?
So the way I'll answer that is, you know, COVID wasn't a thing a year ago. So every day we're learning something new about COVID. So we've learned in March and April, there was a lot of apprehension about the fact that a lot of cancer treatments, you know, some types of chemotherapy can suppress our immune system, with a lot of concerns that suppressing the immune system may worsen how COVID affects someone, meaning that those people could be at higher risk of having worse COVID. That was done from a place in March when we didn't know how COVID was working and trying to be as cautious as possible. So there's been reports, I think, either from the Lancet, but from the National Health System, which is the British overarching healthcare system, that has not demonstrated that COVID has affected patients with cancer as bad as we might imagine, that they don't seem to be at higher risk, even when considering those who are undergoing chemotherapy. But I think what I very much want to underline with that statement is that we are always learning things about COVID. So what we understand about today, we're going to know, just because we know, so, you know, this is not something that us as a world knew about a year ago. We're always learning more. You know, there was suggestion at one point that patients who have hematologic tumors, which means tumors of the blood, like leukemias or lymphomas, might be at higher risk of worse outcomes. But they didn't see that in the United Kingdom. And so it really is this idea then, you know, how do we share what's working? Well, it's through publishing. It's through the fact that those British researchers noted what was happening in the United Kingdom. So as more people continue to publish and as different parts of the world continue to report the effects of COVID in their patient populations, that's how we'll know more.
Well, all right, I'm going to jump in and take this moment to thank Dr. Mayo, because I really have learned something tonight, and I think others must have too, and it was such valuable information, and I loved the way you really tried to make sure we understood the terminology, really tried to make sure we felt comfortable with the information, and it's obvious that you're very good at explaining this, so that's a wonderful skill, and we are grateful.
Yes.
I also want to take a moment to thank Christina Michelle, who has been invaluable in getting this Zoom event started and has been doing this in a variety of ways. And we borrowed her skill and talent for tonight, and I think it's worked beautifully, and I'm personally very grateful to her. And I want to thank all of you that have been able to sign on to our event tonight, because it means a lot to me. We've been doing this, it'll be 3 years in May, and COVID interrupted us for a few months, but getting it restarted and being able to move ahead with something as important as is very personal for me, and I'm just thrilled that you're here. So thank you for taking the time on an evening of the week to join us, and I am very grateful to you for that. There will be the ability for you to answer the survey. If you're an employee, please use that email to let the wellness department know that you participated so that you can get a discount on your health policy. That's a benefit that we're able to take advantage of. And I love that the Prime of Your Life can offer that to you also. So I just wanted
pass to it along.
Dr. Velarde, I see you're here. Is there anything else you want to say before we close?
No, I want to echo everything you said. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. I want to echo everything that you said. I thanking Dr. Mailhot for participating, for groundbreaking, as I said before. And for the audience to pass along the information that we are continuing on with Prime of Your Life, that COVID is not going to stop us, that we will continue offering the education. Life goes on. We have to protect ourselves. You have to wear your mask. You have to physically distance yourself. We are very much in a pandemic, but the learning and the education never stops. And that's our mission. And that's the mission of this program. So please pass along the information. We want to continue to have participants with all the topics that we bring, that we're able to bring to you. And we hope that we can bring Dr. Mailhot again, you know, in the not so long distant future. So thank you all. Thank you, Kathy, for all the work you do. And Christina for helping us.
Yes. spoken so well. And you'll see in your chat box, everybody, that there's a link that Christina's given us for SurveyMonkey, where you, it's just the same questions every time on those evaluations. We're going to continue to use those. So thank you so much. And I just want to close by saying I love you all. I miss you. But this is the best way we can stay together. Please bring your friends and let them know. And I will be sending out information about our next event. Thank you.